Hi, I'm Dr. Chris D'Adamo, the director of the Center for Integrative Medicine at the University of Maryland School of Medicine and a senior program advisor to the Institute for Integrative Health. Today, it's a great pleasure to be able to share with you our work that we truly believe is revolutionizing medical student nutrition education through culinary medicine. And while nutrition and food have had a recent resurgence in our Western medical system, this is not by any means a new philosophy. Food has had its roots in medicine for thousands of years, going back to our first organized medical system of Ayurveda, where foods and food components were used as a basis of medicine, really, including turmeric, the anti-inflammatory orange spice. If you fast forward a few thousand years to traditional Chinese medicine, again, you see foods and food components used as the basis of many treatments. Here you see mushrooms, which have been shown to have powerful immunomodulating properties. And even our own Western medical system has its roots in food, and it was Hippocrates who gave rise to the moniker, let food be thy medicine and medicine be thy food. We see here some of the foods that were used in his day medicinally that, again, Western science had validated to have a variety of immunomodulating properties, fiber to foster gut bacteria, and olive oil for anti-inflammatory properties. However, nutrition has really taken a back seat in medical education today. We look at some of the data here that just 29% of US medical schools met this relatively paltry 25-hour requirement for nutrition education across the 4 years of medical school. It's actually down from the previous decade. Even more concerning is a recent paper in JAMA that found that training and residency was essentially non-existent. And this was a pretty strong statement. Medical education should match the interest in nutrition among both patients and physicians with more action. Okay, so what we're really left with today is well-meaning physicians who want to help their patients, but weren't prepared, don't have the tools to really advise in any meaningful way. You're left with sort of these generalities of it's important to eat a healthy diet. But who do you believe in this? Our patients and us, we're all, this landscape of conflicting ideologies of popular diets. And, you know, what makes this even more confusing to many is that there's actually good data for all the diets that you see on this slide, with the exception of one being the Hollywood cookie diet. The rest of them have some science behind them. And this actually can create even more confusion when, you're really not sure who to believe with this. And what we end up getting is these sort of diet wars and rankings of best diets, pitting diets against one another, both in research and sort of in the blogosphere. And this isn't serving, right? There's not one best diet for everybody. And that's one of the things that we teach our students. We're going to get into this, right? Not one size fits all. And what you see a lot of times is, again, you have this evidence base for many different diets. And these diets are often pitted against one another, and sort of get into camps with this, and then the ideology, people really identifying with their diet in a way that's more than just the food they eat, but almost a community. And in some ways that's okay, but not when it creates a sort of division, yo-yo dieting, bouncing from one to the next, okay? And one of the things that we emphasize with our students, and we all should keep in mind, there's actually data for all of these different types of diets you saw. Despite the acrimony on the blogosphere on the web, low fat, low carb, paleo, vegan, these are all ways to lose weight. Okay, these are, systematic reviews or randomized controlled trials. While weight is often a common outcome, we also see for cardiovascular disease risk, low fat diets, low carbohydrate diets, vegan diets, and paleo diets. These are all systematic reviews that show that these different dietary approaches can all reduce cardiovascular disease risk. You may say these diets are all very different. What's the common ground? Really, it comes down to how they are executed, all right? What I mean by this is it a whole food-based diet? So low-fat diets, if they're done in the manner you see on the top, can be a healthy way to eat. Not sure they're not no-fat, but low-fat, as opposed to the low-fat versions that you see on the bottom, which are gonna cause inflammation and a variety of health issues, Same goes for low carb diets. These are a great way to lose weight, reduce cardiovascular disease risk factors, if you do it the way it's done the top and not relying on heavily processed foods. So as opposed to this sort of emphasis on low fill in the blank, one thing that may be very helpful for patients and for us, the food choices we make, is to focus on a diet that's high in nutrients or a nutrient dense diet. And there's many ways to quantify this. You know, the number of nutrients per serving may be a way. I would advise against looking at per calorie, since healthy fats would be penalized in such a way. Or just really focusing on whole foods instead of processed food. It's not a sexy message, but it is the common underlying theme among all these different diets. Color is another way that would indicate nutrient density, with a lot of these colorful pigments that are in foods. And as we see, actually, this can be done in a variety of ways. This would be a paleo-style diet. There's no one paleo diet, but this could be one of them. Not that much different, really, from vegetarian diets or even vegan diets that would involve some supplements. But the base of these diets is more similar than it is different. And we really do advise people to move beyond the strict dietary dogma. We see this sort of unfolding in society now, things like the Pegan diet, which is a combination vegan and paleo, or Mediterranean paleo, some of these other Michael Pollan's work, that's getting away from, you know, the strict macro nutrient focus or eliminating foods. And then we have these other factors that are important to planetary health. So buying locally, organic, non-GMO, these types of things, and getting beyond that dogma that we've seen pitted against one another. And instead looking more for common ground. All right, as opposed to the pitting, what's the better of two, looking more like a Venn diagram approach. Well, what are some of the commonalities among all these different diets? And I just want to leave you with this image for a second, that this is the way that I think it's best for you. There are many paths to nutrient density. There's no one right way to eat. And if anyone tells you that, they're mistaken. It's that simple. There are many ways to eat healthy. It's not only plant-based. It's not only paleo. It's not only keto. It's not only Mediterranean. It can be any of the above, but there are some caveats. Now, with culinary medicine, this is a way to engage medical students in this type of knowledge in a way that's going to stick. You know, you throw cooking into it to really reinforce these important lessons. Well, this began at Tulane University by a really interesting a physician who had a previous career as a chef. They've been offering it for a number of years now to many medical students. It's now offered at over 25 academic medical institutions. The University of Maryland School of Medicine, we're the only, to my knowledge, to have it in the core curriculum, but it's wonderful to see this movement, really, and outcomes data are being collected across institutions, including our own. I'm very excited about the data that we're going to be publishing soon. If you look at what has been published, we have seen that this culinary medicine education has helped with nutrition counseling abilities and even personal diet quality among medical students at Tulane as compared to sort of your standard lecture-based nutrition education. At other institutions, we've seen many of the same things. Nutrition counseling confidence, knowledge, food identification, more comfort in the kitchen. Okay, so this is, see, these are all relatively recent publications. It's a new movement, but it's gaining steam. Our work has been collaborative with faculty and students from University of Maryland School of Medicine and the Institute for Integrative Health in Baltimore, Maryland, whose wonderful teaching kitchen has hosted all this cutting edge work. We're focusing today on the medical student curriculum, but there's also been work with CME for medical professionals, clinical cooking classes for patients, particularly cancer that are in development, community cooking for optimal health, and engaging underserved families in bear the biggest burden of chronic disease, really cutting across a variety of different areas. The overarching class structure of this begins with practically oriented evidence-based health instruction. So you see here in the picture, this is from some things. This is not looking at nutritional biochemistry. This is really looking at the types of questions that patients or the students themselves are going to ask. You know, should I eat meat or not? We look at what does the data show on this? And is it ever really as simple as yes or no for most of these things? Usually not. We also think it's important to get into some of the barriers to healthy eating. Before we even get into the cooking, you know, avoiding the perfect being the enemy of good, you know, looking at this bad, good, better, best philosophy. And then the big barriers, particularly for medical students, time, taste, and cost. Cost being a big one, both for students, but I'm really encouraged to see this increasing awareness of socioeconomic disparities in health and recognizing that not all patients can shop at Whole Foods, okay? So we really get into a lot of these. You can see very practical tips here across the board. Not forgetting taste, it's very important. Food's gotta taste good for people to stick with it. Let me get into the clinical research of the different diets. So the four that are in the core curriculum, the four diets we do are Mediterranean diets, plant-based diets, paleolithic diets, and ketogenic diets. These are common and they can be useful, but they also, we need to get into some of the details of these. So this can include, as you see, Mediterranean diet, some of the medical research that we search for this and go through all the different studies. The foods that are in and out, as you see for the ketogenic diet picture there. Some of the risks of some of these diets you see with plant-based diets, some of the misconceptions. The paleo diet, for example, is high in red meat. There actually need not be any red meat in it at all if one chooses not to. And then also really how to navigate the nutrition information landscape, where a lot of patients are getting their information from documentaries, which are oftentimes sort of driven by an agenda or a perspective. We go through a lot of these practical types of issues, all grounded in research. Then the fun part for me and the students, and that's cooking together. And finally, there is discussion. And when pre-COVID era, we would eat together. Now, as you see in the Zoom shot image below, this takes the form of questions and answers. And what I'm gonna do now is actually show you a video that was featured. And let's see if I can share another screen and some of the work that we've done. Go ahead and play this to close.
We'll be doing three different recipes. The first section is the avocado mousse. We are starting with dessert.
It's not an ordinary cooking class. It's culinary medicine.
So if you're right in front of that cutting board, I want you to go ahead and pick up that knife.
A required course designed for first and second year medical students at the University of Maryland School of Medicine.
So when you're blending, it gets really immersed in...
One of the first medical schools in the country to offer a nutrition and cooking course as part of the core curriculum.
This is all about practical nutrition, education, behaviors, both for the patients and for the students themselves. We're not just looking to help support the health of future patients, but equally as much to support the wellness of our students.
This is a brand new program. We're excited to be a part of it. What we're providing right now is a couple of different things. Our business solutions, which we have two corporate chefs on staff, which will help with the curriculum, as well as determining products that we're gonna provide at no charge for the program.
It feels so good to see this. You know, we started the University of Maryland Center for Integrative Medicine in the School of Medicine back in 1991. It was the first in the country, and to see how far that it's come, that we can actually have in the required curriculum some culinary health and medicine as part of what the students get exposed to, you know, who knows what's next.
Before going into the kitchen, the medical students receive in-depth nutrition instruction with data from the latest studies and learn about popular diets that their patients will surely ask about.
There's no one right way. This provides patients and our students the latitude to understand food a little bit more than just going when a diet book says.
Culinary medicine is indicative of how the School of Medicine is changing the core curriculum to provide more active learning and keep pace with changing patient needs. And the students are eating it up.
I think being a doctor involves a lot of not just clinical knowledge, but also life knowledge that you might need to pass on to your patients. And for some of these patients, they may not know how to cook or what they can use and what's affordable for them. And by us learning, we can also share this knowledge with our patients and hopefully make it better for them as well.
Culinary medicine also fits in with the curriculum's new emphasis on student wellness.
And learning how to cook well and easy, simple recipes is a great skill to learn as well for ourselves. So it's win-win.
For the University of Maryland School of Medicine, I'm Larry Roberts.
Cheers. Cheers.
All Okay, I appreciate your attention, and it's been a pleasure getting to present this work.